Okay. Looks like we're almost live. Good to go. Okay. How are you guys doing today? You have to let me know in the comments down below where you are located. I'm here in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, and I'm going to need people in the comment section to let me know when this rain cloud behind me is going to just pummel me with preferably rain, hopefully not hail. That's all I'm hoping for right now. Usually Ontario and BC, those are the two that are here first. But we shall see. Today we're going to be talking all about container gardening, and we're going to be going through a ton of stuff today. So you guys are going to have to be sure to put your questions down below, and then I'll get to them as we go through the live as I can. But we're going to be talking about container self-watering, hanging baskets, fabric baskets, you name it. There's so many different products here today to talk about. We have Columbus, Ohio, Regina, Saskatchewan, Kenwood, Saskatchewan, Ottawa. Saskatchewan's on the ball today. We have Vernon, Manitoba. Who else? New Market, Ontario. That one's new. I don't think we've had a New Market, Ontario on here before. Either that or you've been quiet every time we've gone live. If you guys don't know who I am, my name's Ashley and I'm a soil scientist. And I just basically apply science to all things plants. And so self-watering containers and container gardening in general is right up my alley because it can be difficult at times. We have Kitchener, Ontario here. We have Victoria, BC. BC finally showed up. A lot of Ontario and Saskatchewan so far. Lots of Ontario and Saskatchewan. Victoria, BC. Heard there's lots and lots of rain out in BC, which is never a bad thing. Saskatchewan's very, very dry. Well, just Western Canada in general is a little bit. PEI on the map. Rustico PEI. Very cool. That one's new too. I don't think we've had that before. That's pretty awesome. Okay, well, I'm gonna get started. You guys just keep your questions coming down below. I'm going to put my rain jacket, because I'm preemptively waiting for the surprise rain to come in, on my laptop or on my iPad just so it doesn't get wet or it doesn't overheat. So here I have the Lee Valley 5 gallon pail buckets. These are food safe for anyone who's wondering. And in these, I have something called the Grow Tech Garden self-watering container. So we don't have to drill any holes in the bottom of this bucket. And I do find whenever we go around 5 gallons and we're heading into the end of August or the end of the year, things do tend to dry out a lot easier than what they would normally. So one way to prevent that dry out and a really topsy-turvy container is to put a self-waterer in the bottom. So that's what I put in here. And in this, I have a beautiful tumbler tomato. Now, anyone who's grown these knows how big this little plant is going to be by the end of August and how a dry bucket will very easily flop over with the weight of this guy. And we'll be doing a live stream on trellising, and that's actually our next live stream coming up. So I'm going to show you how I set this guy up, because there is some things to keep in mind whenever we're using a setup like this. But the nice part about it is that it is not topsy-turvy, which is incredibly important. So I'm just going to put that little guy down here. He's all nice and full of water. So I have my 5 gallon pail bucket, and a really nice thing about this is that Lee Valley has their barcode on the back. And it's pretty much exactly 3 inches above the bottom of the container. So when it comes to drilling the one hole you do have to drill just to ensure that you don't overwater, it's right on top of this label. But when you drill that hole, you want to be the size of a pencil, they say. So they don't give an exact size, and how big you drill it is completely up to you. Smaller hole means it's just going to drain a little bit slower. Larger hole means it's going to drill a little bit faster. So the bottom of the container looks like this, and this is going to go down this way. And you can see on this side how there's an open face, and this is really common throughout all the self-watering stuff we're going to talk about here today. And so this open face here goes in and you want to line it up exactly with that barcode there. So when this goes into the bucket, you want to make sure that you can see the barcode through the inside and that you match it up exactly. And this is going to ensure that everything will drain properly. So when we have the bottoms of our containers, we also have all these other fancy doodads. Now, to install this, it's pretty simple. All you're going to do is take this PVC pipe and you're going to pop it onto here. There's no sealant that is needed. And then your indicator is going to go on top. Now, there are labels that you can use for the front of this. I encourage you to get something called a garden marker. It's a UV resistant marker that will allow you to write the labels on your containers, and they are UV stabilized, so they won't disappear with the UV light. So this goes on here, and this little lip is exactly what goes over the bucket side, and you just pop this on. So that's kind of what it looks like. And then you install this last. So I was fighting with this when I was trying to set up the test version, and I kept on trying to make this line up when it was already in the tube, but common sense eventually kicked in. So assemble it, it's just two pieces, and then you're going to stick it through the bottom and bring it up through this hole. Now this is your indicator. When this gets low, it means it's time to top up with water. And then when it's high, it means it's full. So it rained here today in Saskatoon earlier this morning. So my GrowTech self-waterer for my 5-gallon pill buckets is really, really high up right now because of that. So once you slip this in, that's it. And then when you go to fill it, you would fill from this screen here. You would not water on top, you fill from right here. So the next question becomes, what kind of fertilizer should you be using if you're using a self-watering container? And the answer to that is granular can be mixed in throughout the entire soil. But when we're talking about a very large plant in a relatively small volume of soil, I would actually encourage you to use a liquid fertilizer. So all you're going to do is use liquid fertilizer at full strength, either organic or synthetic, either or. And you're going to pre-mix it in a watering can or a separate bucket and then funnel it into this one here. So that goes for all the self-watering containers we're talking about. If you're using synthetic and you're concerned about the potential for burning or something like that, you can simply use like an organic, which will help prevent that. You just want to ensure that it's a water-soluble form of liquid fertilizer. So either already in a liquid format or a granular version that can be dissolved very easily and then placed inside. So once you fill that up, the monitor will go up, such as what you saw with the last container, to indicate that it's full. And then over time, it will go down. I wouldn't water or add any water until it has gone down all the way. If you're continually topping up, there's a potential that you could cause, you know, maybe too much water or dampening off of the roots. And so to prevent against that, you just want to let this go down a little bit over time. By the end of the summer, I would expect you to have to water this probably once every 3 days. In the beginning of the summer, it wouldn't shock me if you guys can get away from the month of June, maybe watering once every 2 weeks. So that's the 5-gallon pail bucket version. If you have a heavy duty enough shepherd's hook, you could technically hang this, but other than that, this is a great solution for anyone who wants to container garden but doesn't have necessarily the room and wants to grow a full-size tomato plant. This is most definitely your solution there. So I'm just gonna see if we have any questions coming up. We have Lachine, Quebec. We have Excellent Chance from Twitch says hi, and is from Sask as well. We have a Twitch user from Sask as well. Surrey, BC, Portland, Oregon, and Vancouver. Hello, hello. Okay, so next up, we'll just stay with the theme of self-watering for now. Next up, we have the ginormous self-waterer. I didn't even know this exists until I went to Saskatoon and Lee Valley pulled this out and was like, we want you to show this off. So this is actually very, very cool. This is a raised bed self-watering kit. So this is what I believe it's an 8x8, but let me just check here. So it's 8 inches by, so you need 4 pieces of 8x1x63, and then 4 pieces of 32 inch lumber, and 12 cubic feet of soil, or 28x0.3 liters of quality potting soil mix. So this is actually very, very cool. You can use the brackets that come with the kit, and these brackets actually are sold separate as well. And they're really, really unique. I'm just gonna show you what they look like, because they make it really easy to actually service the self-water. And they also make it really easy to get underneath your bed after it's been established, because they are on hinges. So these clamps go into the ground like this, and then the raised bed boards are put onto this, and they simply go around, and this is what the self-waterer looks like. So what you're going to make is a rectangle. So it's two of these squares wide by 4 squares long, which is just a typical classic raised bed. And you're going to treat it the same way. So you have your top tap here that you fill, and then you can add your fertilizer into that, but you want to use potting soil with this. You do not want to use soil. Very important there. I'm going to set this up probably this weekend, because I ordered some soil and it's just getting delivered. And then you'll see this in the trellising video, because I'm going to put a trellis behind this when we do the live stream. So I'll show you what the completed setup looks like that with these brackets. But what I will say is, if you're looking to build the raised bed with the bracket, Lee Valley on Saturday at all the Lee Valleys across Canada has 2 chances, once in the morning and once in the afternoon. It's 2 to 4 and then 10 to, I'm gonna have to look. Leanne will get me hooked up. So it's 10 to 12 and 2 to 4. And in that, we're going to be talking about all things drip irrigation. So there's going to be a presentation done by Lee Valley Tools. You can bring in either a sketch of what your planters look like, if you're doing container gardens, or if you're doing in-ground beds, or if you're deciding to buy some brackets, maybe install some of your own raised beds, all the way to just even a mapping out of what you have. And they have a ton of different options. So I was just in Lee Valley here last week, and they had a whole setup. They have so many different options for drip irrigation, some I didn't even know existed. And they are going to walk you through everything you need to get that installed properly. So if you want to do a raised bed with just the brackets with the drip irrigation in place, then I would go to that one of those 2 seminars, and they will most definitely help you out. So wonderful idea, and this kit is very, very cool. Can you use self-watering raised bed kit in a square garden container? So these are, I was looking into this because me and my husband were talking about how we were gonna set this guy up. And you have to follow the actual mold itself, because the basin of it that you fill the water with has to follow exactly this design. If it's a square, it won't have the bottom part, similar to like the bottom of the bucket. And so water will just leach out any which way. So it does have to follow the format of this. So it is a rectangle. There is no other option for design, because that was one of our questions too, when we were looking at where we were gonna set this up and stuff. So, but I'll get this set up. I just ran out of time, to be honest. And then when we do our next live stream end of June, I will have a trellis behind this and we'll do trellising, but I'll also show you kind of what this looks like, because this is actually very, very cool. The position we're placing it in is full sun, very, very warm conditions. And we found it very hard to even container garden there, due to the heat and due to that excess sun. So this is going to solve a lot of our issues. So if you have an area that's like really intense heat and things tend to evaporate very easily, you're having a hard time getting things like seeds to germinate, this would be the solution for that. So very, very cool kit. I'm going to move on to hanging baskets. So this one is one of my favorite hacks out there. So this is just your classic peat liner or coconut coir liner inside of a metal basket. Now I have these all over my yard and I grow veggies in them and I grow flowers in them. It kind of just depends where in the yard I'm placing it. So one thing I've always done since I started gardening was actually use a plastic liner. And now this is just the bio bags, the compostable bio bags from Lee Valley Tools. And these are food safe. They're certified organic as well. So if you were to put a tumbler tomato in here or any sort of edible, fine. Cucumbers do well in hanging baskets, things like that, whatever you would choose to put in here. And so what I like to do is just simply place the bag in the bottom. And I'm just going to, you guys can see me. So I place it in the bottom and then I tuck it up around the sides. And then when I fill this with soil, I will fill this entire basin and then I will tuck the actual plastic down on the sides. And so what happens when we do this is this holds water. And we don't have to water as often. Sometimes with these hanging baskets, by the time we get to the end of the year, we may have to water twice a day. But this little certified organic compostable bag placed in the bottom of our hanging baskets will help eliminate that issue entirely. Or you can go and get that drip irrigation installed from Lee Valley Tools. And then again, you won't have to worry about that. I think one of the main issues whenever we're dealing with any sort of hanging basket is that they dry out a little bit too quickly. With that being said, because it's such a small basin and we're relying on things like the granular fertilizer in some cases to do all the work for us, one thing you want to consider is, again, that liquid version of fertilizer, organic or synthetic, either or will work, but that's going to help supply nutrients continuously despite the small volume of soil that we're dealing with in these tiny containers. So that's another one where I would go with the liquid or dissolvable powder forms for the hanging baskets as well. With the raised bed guy, you could actually go with granular because you're dealing with such a large volume and you'll be just fine. Big guy C, I had to come back and say I'm starting to get stuff for my hydroponic setup from the last stream I was in. That's awesome. Yeah, hydro is pretty, I personally love hydro setups. I find them to be like really quick at producing produce and very prolific. I find it to be one of the fastest way to get food indoors and outside. Like I have hydro downstairs and I absolutely love it. We have Esther from Mexico. Wow, saying hi. I'm turning my spare bedroom into a garden. Big guy C. Yeah, that's really cool. And those actually self-watering buckets, that would be a good one to try indoors. It would work very, very nicely. So next up I have the cloth bags. Now these are really cool for being able to grow. I gotta try to get this big guy up. There we go. So these guys are really great for actually growing exotic plants such as peppers. I have a pepper in here. I have a pepper back here. And then I have, what else? I have colored kale in here as well. You can do things like okra and just things that generally need very warm soil. They're going to do really, really great in these geo pots. So this one's a 7-gallon and this one is a 10-gallon one. So inside of this one, I have one pepper and 3 kale. And then I also planted 3 nasturtium seeds. They just haven't germinated yet. I only got this guy ready last night. So he has 3 nasturtiums, 3 kale. So kind of 3 spillers, and then 1 thriller, as we like to call it. So this guy is jalapeno. And then the one I have down here is actually a super hot. So anyone who grows peppers knows that the super hots are incredibly difficult to grow in Canada. But when we're using something like the cloth pots, we can see really, really great results. So with the 10 gallon, again, because it's such a large container, we can get away with a granular slow release or like a blood meal or a bone meal mix inside of this. If we are dealing with something like the 7 gallon and we're trying to do the tomatoes or peppers in here, it's a little bit on the smaller side. So I would do more of like a liquid version as well. And one of the nice things about these in Canada is anyone who has ceramic pots, let me know in the comments down below if you've experienced the dreaded crack. So this is terracotta, glazed ceramics, and even plastics over time, just dealing with Canadian winters. Even if we store them perfectly fine, they crack, they break, they fall apart because of the freeze-thaw cycle we experience. But the nice part about these cloth pots is not only do they store very, very nicely if we have a smaller area to deal with, they also, we're not going to deal with the falling apart process. So I have some of these that are not even close to the same quality as this Geopot. You can just feel the fabric quality here. And I've had them for about 5 years. This one's gonna last even longer. And the ones that I had from before are still doing just fine. So this is collapsible. We can hang it up in storage in our shed for the winter. And the other really unique feature about cloth pots is we get something really unique called root trimming. So when, or air pruning is what we like to call it too. So whenever we have a plant that has roots, which is all of them, and they get close to the edges of a cloth pot, they hit air. And when a root hits air, it's very similar to the video we did on topping or the video that we did on grafting. Whenever we clip or remove something, it sends hormone back into the base of the plant to cause a branching or an expansion of the plant itself. It makes a bushier plant over time. And so with the peppers, when the roots tend to air prune on their own, we end up with splitting. So our roots get bigger and better, meaning we can get really high yields in some cases. And those high yields are purely caused by the fact that we're getting the air pruning action happening. Roots hate air. And when they're exposed to air, they will dry off and they will collapse and then expand elsewhere in the plant. So we get better water capture. We get even better nutrient capture, you name it. And that goes for any of these pruning pots. So exotic plants, if I'm going to grow them, they're going to be done inside of these cloth pots because these are hands down going to yield the best results. The other nice thing about the cloth pots is that they are lightweight and they can also be brought inside. So if you did not know, and this may be a future live stream you can do, you can bring things like peppers indoors. So I will take some of my houseplants outside in the summer, let them get a little bit of extra sunlight, and I will also bring some peppers inside as well. And this will give us a head start in the season so we can produce more peppers quicker, and ultimately slowly transform what we typically see as only a plant or an annual in Canada into something closer to a bush or a tree in some cases, depending on how long we can hold on to them for. So, do you still recommend liquid fertilizer for containers that are not self-watering? Yeah, I do. So this one, for example, is one I would use. This one I would use liquid with. This one I would use granular, but you could also use liquid. I would always go with whatever's most convenient for you, whatever one you are most likely to actually use. So if you aren't going to use liquid or you're a forgetful person or just a busy person, then just go with granular. You want to supply them with something. And so that's sometimes your best option. If you are very forgetful or just incredibly busy, want to set it and forget it, with either the self-watering or the pot versions, you can do 50% compost, 50% potting soil. So do a 50-50 mix between the two, and then this will help encourage nutrient capture without any burning or any worry of burning. And it will allow you to fertilize all year, regardless of what version of this you are deciding to use. So that is the other option, would be a 50-50 between compost and the potting soil. And the compost doesn't have to be anything special. It can be your regular vegetable compost, or it can be something more unique, like a mushroom compost. That is totally up to you. But so long as it's compost, stay away from manure. It can get, I mean, with containers like the cloth, you may see a crusty white on the outside when we use something higher in manure, a little bit higher in calcium carbonate. That's totally normal, and these do go in the washing machine on low very easily. Just don't put them in the dryer, hang dry them, but you can get those crusties off the edges if you need to. Duncan on Facebook says, what's PA? I think you're, yeah, so PAG is actually not relative to gardening, but it's for giving advice on farm stuff. So it's a professionalism's ethics certificate. So it's basically an ethics test that you do where you say you can't lie. That's what it comes down to. Do your bags break down into microplastics? Yeah, so Ree, that's actually a really good question. And that's why I use the bio bag. So like these are, you get these in a huge roll from Lee Valley Tools. This one's 3 gallons, and I use these in my compost bins. These are certified compostable and organic, and I was looking these guys up. So the it meets the standard ASTM D64000. And my understanding when I was researching this was that that is not, it doesn't give off the microplastics. It's made out of something completely different, a completely different material. I believe this is vegetable based. And I know this looks like plastic on film, but if you felt this, you would know exactly what I'm talking about. It feels very, very different. It's like a soy based product. It's very interesting. So I would look into that a little bit more. Do your research, of course. You never want to do anything you're uncomfortable with any of these things. I know plastics are a concern for some people, but my understanding to date is food safe plastic. It's fine. And that would include 5-count bale buckets, things like that, self-watering systems, all of which are a recyclable number that is are food safe. Do you use a biodegradable liner in the cloth pots? So with the cloth pots, I don't use any biodegradable liners solely because I have a very large volume of soil. So this one here is 10 gallons. So this is 2 5-gallon bale buckets worth of soil in here. So when I was filling all my stuff, I got the big Sunshine Mix number 5 bales. I think it's like $40. And that filled this one, this one, this one, and that 5-gallon pail bucket. And I'm totally out of potting soil. So these actually hold a substantial amount of soil, and they do compact over time. So you will need to top up, but I do not use any sort of plastic liner inside of these, solely because they're too big for the plastic liners. And I don't find that they dry out really that quickly. If they do, what I tend to do when I go on holidays, for example, and this may be a live stream idea, I put it in a kiddie pool. So I buy a little cheap kiddie pool. They're like $10 or whatever, probably more now. But I fill that with water, and I will place my cloth pots in the bottom of it, and then they will capillary action wick up all the water that I need while I'm out on holidays, and everything's good to go. So that is what I do whenever I go on holidays. And that's also the other reason why I like the cloth pots so much, because they are so porous. They make it very easy to go on vacation and set it and forget it and not have to worry about it drying out. So, Mechaform on Twitch says the Mecca Ladies terracotta pots are all in shards. I believe that. I mean, this year I was cleaning out this one area in the yard and where I kind of store all my pots, And it's literally at the point where probably 2 out of 4 are just cracked into a million pieces. So I believe you there. Do you have to put something under the cloth bags to protect the house floors? Bill over on Facebook, you would. So if you brought these indoors, you would have to put them on top of something. Now I use grow tents. So they have like a mylar bottom in them. So that would work. I just set up like an indoor garden at a business here locally in Saskatoon not too long ago. And we were using Rubbermaid container tops. So he had a whole bunch left over that he wasn't using them for anything. So I actually put the pots on top of those and they have like a little bit of a basin in them to help with that. And then you can use just bits and bobs like that, pie plates, that sort of thing, roasters, but these will leak out through the bottom, same as any sort of pot would. The only ones indoors that won't do that, if you were to bring them inside and you want to plant a pepper in it, would be the 5-gallon pail Lee Valley Tools buckets, food safe with the self water in the bottom. And then you would use the liquid granular in that case. Yeah, so cloth bags, do they leak water? If yes, how do you? Yeah, same thing. But just use the Rubbermaid tops, like for the blue Rubbermaids. You know how they're indented and then they kind of have the lips on the outside? That's what I would use there in that case. There also is at Lee Valley Tools. They have a really beautiful lighting setup with their nice heavy-duty plastic trays. They almost look like the bottoms of dog kennels, you know, with the removable bottoms on it. It's exactly what it looks like. These cloth pots would do very well on there as well because it has that little dish in there to prevent water from overflowing onto the sides. Are we okay using substitute fertilizer with worm castings? Yeah, you can. So worm castings don't burn. They're considered organic. So you'd be totally fine using a worm casting mix inside your potting soil. So again, if you were using no other fertilizer, you could do a 50-50. But if you were incorporating other fertilizers, I would do like a 25%, the rest being potting soil. And actually, fun fact about the worm casting is that they have chitin in them. And so the chitin means that they will cause an autoimmune response that makes the plant think that it's under attack from bugs. And so that will help to strengthen the plant, both root-wise and foliage-wise, against any onslaught attacks in the future. So that's just a little fun fact about worm castings. Okay, so Lee Valley Tool product tip. Just got research back on this. So the compostable bags are made from vegetable oils and cornstarch. I knew they were made from plants of some sort. Yeah, that's what those bio bags are for. And that's what I've lined this year, because now that I know that these exist, I just found out a few months ago, I've lined literally all my hanging baskets with those bio bags. How frequently do you recommend your fertilizing container plants? I've seen suggested every monthly. So if you're using a self-water, that's why I say let that indicator come down. Don't necessarily just refill it willy-nilly. It will be every 2 weeks for a vast majority of fertilizers, but always follow the manufacturer recommended usage of fertilizer. So if they're saying once every 2 weeks, you only add it once every 2 weeks. If your self-watering pot uses up that addition within 2 weeks, you would just add regular water. You would not add water that has had any sort of additions to it. And the manufacturer is going to know their rules. So I recommend you follow their rules. I can tell you how often to do it, but it could be completely different because everyone has their instructions based on the dosages that they're dealing with. What's the best materials for DIY cloth pots for kids projects? Thank you so much. So DIY cloth pot, I've seen lots of versions. One of my favorite is potato sacks. They are all over the place. Farmers are trying to get rid of them willy-nilly all the time. So that's like a juke twine type style. There's also anything heavy. It has to be heavy and it has to be double layered. So I've gotten some single layered ones. And I've actually tried to cheat the system a couple times by using the shopping bags, and they tend to rip pretty quickly by the end of the year typically. So you want to go with something heavy. These geopots, I'm not sure what these are made out of, but like I said, they're very unique feeling. Like, they're pretty darn heavy duty. So, but we only have 10 more minutes left. So I do want to talk about some other stuff here, because we have lots of really unique ones. And Leanne is going to bring up on the screen the veg pod, which is one of their best sellers, which is a really unique version. Oh my God. Okay, that's okay. We'll show you a different one. So here behind me, I just want to make sure you guys can see this one. Yeah, you can. Okay. So this one here is a self-watering container. So they have quite a few versions of this. They have an even larger one called the veg pod. This one here is called the Elo. No, this one's the Elo. Can't remember what this one's called. How did I forget? Elsa, okay, she'll send the link out for that one. So this one here is a self-watering container, has a nice little storage stand underneath. And this one has the self-watering area up here with a nice little cap on top, which is very helpful because debris will get inside of these very easily. And you want to make sure you always put, if it comes with any sort of a cap, you want to reinstall that cap. It's very important. If you don't, you run the risk of potentially clogging up some of the plumbing, which ultimately will stop things like the indicator on the side from working. So with this guy, we have a tiny indicator on this one side here. It has a max fill line, so that'll tell you when you hit your max. I was experimenting because I want to give you guys the best product review here, but when you fill this and you go above the max, it literally just drains out all over the place and it just comes right out of an emergency valve. So there's no concerns about overwatering, very similar to that of a 5 gallon pail bucket. So again, with this guy, you want to make sure that you are continually fertilizing with that liquid. Granular will work, but what I did instead, because it is a large basin, you could use granular and do one or two plants. But what I did instead was I'm going to be using liquid fertilizer in this, and I planted this really nice and heavy. So I did two sets of jalapeno peppers, and then I did a super hot in the middle. So this one is, what brand? This is a ghost pepper in here. So very, again, exotic plant for Canada. Then I did some colored kale, which is very, very pretty plant. And then in the front here, you can't quite see them yet, but I did some zinnias. And so this, by the end of the season, we're gonna do a garden tour, and this is gonna look absolutely beautiful. So I put in the front about, I did 8 zinnias in the front, 2 kale, 3 peppers. It's very heavily planted, but that's the beauty of the self-watering planters, as we can really stockpile a lot of plants in here. And because our nutrients and our water is coming from a bottom source, it gives us really, really great results. And the same thing goes with the other raised bed planter that they have. They come in small, medium, and large. They are huge, and they have a beautiful bug netting, self-watering features, all that sort of stuff. So it's really going to protect your plants and keep them nice and healthy. So this one here, I don't want to lift up because he does come off of the container, but you can kind of see him. So this one is the Elo, and this again is a self-watering container. And in here we have the netting that will allow your plants to crawl up. So inside of this one, I did morning glories. You could also do patio cucumbers, snap peas, sweet peas, anything of that nature would do very, very well in here. Some things I wouldn't recommend, only because the trellis is a little bit on the small side, would be things like runner beans, which can get very, very large. Any sort of squash would be too much weight for trellising something like this. But if you guys want to see squash trellising type stuff, let me know in the comments down below, and we can make sure to incorporate that in the next live stream, which is on trellising. And this is for more lighter size plants. So morning glories is one. And if you love the look of a morning glory, but you don't like the invasiveness of a morning glory. So if you're in Ontario or BC, morning glories are incredibly invasive plants. Container gardening is a great place to go, and this Elo self-watering container is the perfect application for that. Because it's a contained container, we don't have to worry about things like invasive species getting into surrounding soils or anything of that nature. So that is the Elo guy here. He doesn't have a min-max. He has a spillover system in the back. So you water from the top and then it spills out through the base on the back end and onto the ground. So that's kind of what the Elo looks like. And this one we'll also be showing again when we do a live stream on the trellising. We'll bring this guy back in the picture and my morning glories will be starting to trellis up it. And I'll show you left-handed versus right-handed plants and how to get things to trellis properly so they don't look all goofy and wibbly and wobbly over in your yard. So do you guys have any more questions? We have exactly 4 minutes left when it comes to container gardening. If not, I will guess tell you a little bit more if I can about just the fertilizer side of it, because it sounds like that's one of the things. Yes, please, to squash trellising. I love to grow zucchinis upwards instead of sprawling. Yeah, so that's a sibling. You officially helped me out there. I will aim to specifically incorporate that in the next video for you. So I actually have some zucchinis started. So I will be sure to get that trellising for you so that the end of June, when we do the trellising live stream, I can actually show you how to trellis zucchinis. Anyone out here who did not know that, one of the best ways to grow zucchinis, get really nice high yields, keep the powdery mildew off of them, keep the bugs out, is to trellis them. So pest prevention 101, trellising. And zucchinis are very easy to trellis, and they actually are pretty darn tall plants if you trellis them properly. And they're much easier to actually harvest as well. Excellent Chance said, I started spinach in April and just got them in the ground. I think they start to bolt. Should I pull them and start again? Yes. So spinach, that's one of those plants where every month you should be starting a new run. So if you're doing any sort of spinach, container gardening is actually a really great way to do them. And moving them into a shadier spot whenever possible is ideal. The reason for that is because they do not like heat. And right now, even in Saskatchewan, I know that they are bolting. I've had it happen here last week. So if you planted your spinach, harvest them now, and then make sure to do another replant, harvest, replant, harvest. Repaw, more details about Heavenly Blue, Ipoma Tricolor. It's a great shame that some of you are confused. I really hear me. Oh, yeah. Trumpet flowers. I've seen those before as well. Actually, my husband's brother out in Blaine Lake, his neighbor, grows quite a few of the trumpet flowers as well. Janet Carlson, what size of cloth bag should I use for a tomato plant? So if you're doing a tomato plant and it's not a micro or determinate tomato, so if it's an indeterminate tomato like a beefsteak, a Roma, any of those ones, a paste tomato, a salsa tomato, those I would put in a 10-gallon cloth. Anything that is a determinate tomato or a small tomato or a cherry tomato, something of that nature, you could use the 7-gallon just fine, or the 5-gallon pail bucket with a self-watering system would work great for any of those options because you're able to control that water. Nadia, I use soil out of the bag and don't add anything. I have a Dracaena clethea that does not grow and looks healthy. How can I grow its okay. Yeah, so if you potting soil naturally does have some slow release fertilizer in it typically. Sometimes with those Dracaenas, I do find that they need quite a bit of light. So I would slowly harden him off to outdoors. If you're going to put him outside, don't just transition him like right away and be done with it. You want to do it slowly over time, over a period of 2 weeks. So you're going to bring him outside for an hour or two a day, put him in sun, bring him inside, do that on and off for about 2 weeks, and then you can put him outside in full sun. He will thank you for it, but nice and slow, because you can sunburn your plant and cause some shock there. So you want to do that very gently, or you want to get a grow light. So actually at Lee Valley, there's quite a few different options for the grow lights, such as that system I was talking about before. Lighting is key with those guys. They do not do well with just simple window light, that is for sure. And make sure to keep the water up. Your nutrient isn't available to your plant without that water being available as well. It's been so cold here in Sask. Yes, it has been. Yeah, I'm sure people are watching and be like, oh, it's beautiful out. It's really not that warm though. It's only about, well, it's 20, my watch says 20 degrees Celsius, but yeah, it's not super warm here in Saskatchewan. And it took a really long time for our spring to hit, which is why all my plants look so much tinier than people, you know, from other areas in Canada. I feel like I'm so far behind, but our last frost date, I think, was just 2 weeks ago, for whatever reason. So what kind of soil is best for veggies? Yeah, so for veggie soil, you can use potting soil, works very, very great, very, very good. And potting soil actually works wonderfully with root veg and potatoes, tomatoes, things like that. And I want to show you this. Hold on 1 second. I forgot one thing and then we're done because I talk too long, guys. This is the one that I forgot. So this one's really cool. This is from Lee Valley Tools as well. This is a food safe bucket. It's about 3 gallons. 3 gallons, I'm pretty sure is what it said. And this is really unique. So inside of this, you plant potatoes. So I'm going to be doing 2 potatoes. I have not chitted these or cut these. If you cut potatoes, you could cut these in several ways. I actually bought these for a YouTube video because they're so bizarre looking. And I want to just experiment. Plus, it's a good science project because I can show people what everything looks like. But inside of here, there is an insert. So I'm going to probably break it trying to get the insert out. So I'm not going to. But inside of this, there is an insert. I didn't have time to set this up, but the insert allows you to harvest your potatoes as they become ready without harming the potato plant. So it's like a little tiny grate. You pull out the top, and it has all the potato babies inside. You harvest them, and then you slip it back into place, and your potato plant is fine, and it will allow your potato plant to grow year after year. So I'm going to be using regular potting soil with this guy, and I'm going to take my potatoes and their bizarreness, and I'm going to place them in the bottom with these stems going upwards, and I'm going to fully bury them entirety all the way to the top, and I'm going to water them as regular, and that is going to yield some awesome results and very, very high potato yields. The reason why I'm doing 2 full potatoes in here is because I have that option to actually harvest from the container as the potatoes appear without running the risk of overcrowding, because I will be removing them as they're ready without harming the plant. So you can, again, plant a little bit heavier handed with this sort of setup, and you can also do potatoes in the 5 gallon pail buckets as well. So it looks like we're over time, but just a little bit this time, not horribly over time. I want to thank you guys so much for joining in today. We're back again 2 weeks from today on Thursday. Once again, same time, same place. So be sure to sign up for that. We're going to be doing trellising. So we are most definitely doing summer squash, aka zucchini, because that was a special request there. And then I will be re-showing what the morning glories look like on this. It's a beautiful plant. But other than that, that's all I have for you guys. I want to thank you so much for joining, and be sure to check out that self-watering drip irrigation seminar over at Lee Valley Tools, any of the Lee Valley Tools across Canada, 2 sessions, 10 to 12 or 2 to 4, and be sure to bring in your photos so we can get your garden set up really nice and good. So you're watering all year round, despite the fact that it's a drought. I'll talk to you guys next time. Bye.